Good morning. How's everyone doing? Am I on? Can you hear me? Okay, good. If you have your Bibles, I encourage you to turn with me to Daniel. We're going to study the book of Daniel. So we're going to see some prophecy. How many know we're living in the last days, what Daniel's talking about, a lot of it. And so it's good for us to know prophecy. I tend to be a New Testament guy. I don't know if the Old Testament's just too smart for me or too hard for me, but I like to teach the New Testament a lot of times, but people, you guys have challenged me, let's mix it up and have Old Testament, New Testament. So I'm teaching the book of Daniel. Really felt like God. I was reading it in the one-year Bible, and how many know there's just so much good stuff in Daniel if you've ever studied it before. So the title of today's message is the intro to Daniel. I'm just going to do an intro of Daniel so you can see all the cool things about it, because I think it's really, really neat. Let's pray and ask God to speak to us. Father, thank you so much for this day. Thank you for your love. Thank you for this Christmas season, to where even the world remembers you and might not remember you quite the way they should, but Lord, thank you that this is a time, as Kevin was saying, that where people are sensitive to remember the reason for the season, it's Jesus. And so, Father, thank you for that. I pray that we would invite our friends to come to the Christmas service, that there will be a chance for people to respond to Christ. And our heart is, Lord, that you would grow your church, not just this church, but the church in general, the true church of America. Lord Jesus, we see revival going on everywhere but America. But, Lord, we pray that you would bring it back here, Lord. Amen. Let a revival be here. Let people get saved. Let Christians walk with you, Lord, not just believing they're saved, but really living it, really having that fruit in their lives, Lord, of obedience to you. That's our heart, Lord. We want to be those lights in the darkness. We want to let your light shine in and through us so this world sees the reality of Jesus. There's so much darkness out there, but Lord, thank you that just like when someone shows diamonds, they put it on the backdrop of black velvet. Lord, thank you that in a sense this world really gives us an opportunity to shine bright for you. Amen. So, Lord, let us shine. Lord, fill us with your Holy Spirit. Empower us, Lord, and speak to us today through your word. Speak to us, even this intro, speak to us, Lord. And may we be changed. May it not be good suggestions or good knowledge, but may you, Lord, be able to take that knowledge of your word and then see it lived in and through our lives. Bless your people. Bless me as I teach and speak your word, and bless those who hear it, whether it be here, in the lobby, or on the internet. Lord, speak, I pray. In Jesus' most powerful name. And every greed said, Amen. Well, Daniel was both a saint and he was a prophet or a seer. How many know the word seer means a prophet? And so he was a seer. And he was a saint, and his book, because of that he was a saint, his book was extremely practical. As we study the life of Daniel and his friends, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, we see a commitment. We see a conviction, a courage in standing up against the world system and standing up for the Lord. How many know we need that today? We need that courage because everything is screaming to be silent. Everything is screaming to us to be quiet. I want to tell you this. How many know the Muslims aren't quiet? How many know the homosexuals aren't quiet? Amen. The liberals aren't quiet. And so we need to make sure that we're speaking the truth in love. Amen. And that we will not be silenced, because guess what? We have not a message, we have the message. Amen? Remember Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Not a way, not a truth, not a life. The only way, the only truth, the only life, and it's found through Jesus Christ. So we should be bold in proclaiming that in love. Amen? We need to. We have to, because the world is dying without Jesus. This book is an inspirational example to us and has tremendous lessons for us about how we are to walk in the world in which we live. But hear this, because Daniel was also a prophet or a seer, the book is very prophetic. It's perhaps the most prophetic book, scholars say, in the entire Bible. It is the most prophetic book. The Daniel is also the key that unlocks the book of Revelation. If you've ever studied the book of Revelation, you always see how you go back to Daniel, how there's so much reference to Daniel, and we need to see that. So if you ever studied Revelation, if you've studied it and not understood it, you need to probably study Daniel. Without understanding Daniel, the book of Revelation would just be an enigma. It would just be a mystery. But because much of Daniel's prophecies have already been fulfilled, his book, which book confounds the critics, Because he was so accurate in his prophecies, critics around the year 300 AD, after the death of Christ, 300 years, the theory was introduced that the reason Daniel was so accurate in his prophecies was because although he declared he wrote the book in 600 BC before Christ, it wasn't actually written until AD 50. Now hear this, guys, that you say, okay, this is kind of boring, but hear this. We have to realize that there's these higher critics, amen? There's these supposed higher critics from seminaries, and the U of A has a religious department, right? And how many know these critics base a lot of their criticism on what? Nothing. I forget there was one book, David Barton was saying there's a book that was talking about against Christ, and he says, we've dispensed with the normal footnotes because you can trust what we say. Wouldn't you love to do that to a professor at high school or college? I don't need footnotes. You just trust, professor, what I say is true. I mean, that's the kind of stuff they do. So these higher critics really, I think they're high, but they're not higher critics. Amen? Hold on, come on, that's kind of funny. But they're higher critics, but they're not really that smart. And hear this, they say it was written, in AD 50. In other words, they say the book of Daniel, a lot of these, even seminary professors say it's a fake. This heresy is often repeated by these so-called scholars, and it's repeated even to this day. Thus, in his own day, Daniel was placed in the lion's den. Remember that? Lion was his place. But how many know today he's being trying to be placed in what? The liar's den. I got that from John Corson. Yeah. He does it a lot better because he goes, ho, 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 afterwards, and he makes you laugh at his laugh. So it's good. I don't have that. But either these higher critics are incredibly ignorant, or they're downright fraudulent. I think it's both. Amen. I think it's downright fraudulent because, how many know, did anyone ever watch The Truth Project? Do you remember the guy about evolution? He said this is from Stanford. He said, I know that evolution, this couldn't happen by chance. But he said it sure beats the alternative. Do you hear that? It's saying I have to believe in a theory that doesn't make sense, because if I believe in a creator, then I need to know that creator, and I need to be obedient. And this man, I think, was a homosexual. You could kind of tell. But so, how many know? A lot of people do not want to. It says in 1 Peter 3 that they are willfully ignorant. Why is someone willfully? I always think it's amazing, hear this, that I always think it's amazing how angry the atheists get on how not real God is. That's right. Isn't that amazing? I mean, do you ever get mad at the boogeyman? Do you ever say to your kid, you cannot believe in the boogeyman! Stop it! I mean, you go, he's not real. Come on, stop. But these people get so angry. And how do you get so angry of a God that you, if you say you truly don't believe, you'd say, come on, guys. You know, come on. But there's an anger over this God that they don't believe. And they spend so much. And I don't know if you saw the Tim Hawkins. We showed a Tim Hawkins video a little other day. But they have mega atheist churches now. Now, how do you have an atheist church? You know? It's kind of weird. But anyways, that's the days we live in. So they're either fraudulent, one has to do, and here I'm going to show you some things that prove how they're false, these higher critics. All you have to do is look to the Septuagint. The Septuagint was written in 285 BC before Christ. It is the Greek translation of the Old Testament. And guess what book is in the Septuagint? The book of Daniel, you guessed it. Now, that's amazing that it was written in AD 50, they say, but yet it was in the Septuagint that was over 300 years before that. He could project things, I guess, astral projection. He projected it back. You know, I mean, come on. Crazy. But there it is. So how could it have been written in AD 50 when it was in the Septuagint, as I said, 285 BC? Here's another point. Alexander the Great. Ever heard of Alexander the Great? Well, Alexander the Great, as he was conquering most of the known world, he came to the Middle East, and Josephus, the historian, writes that as he came to the city of Jerusalem to besiege it, the high priest came out to him and met him and said, Alexander, you're mentioned in the Bible. And then he proceeded to open the book of Daniel and show him where he fit in the prophetic picture. and how 300 years earlier than when he came on Jerusalem, that he was prophesied to come. Isn't that amazing? It's almost like the Bible is prophetic. It's almost like God really knows all things. Isn't it amazing? Let me just say this to you real quick to prove this. The Mormons have a book that talks about, I don't know if it's Pearl of Great Price or what, but they talk about this great war that was in upstate New York. And they said it was on this mountain and this big hill. And they said the Aztecs came up and they had all these weapons, metal weapons. Well, history's proven the Mayans, they didn't have metal weapons. But they said they did. And so they did all this research. They dug because there's supposed to be like thousands of people killed there. They checked out not one artifact found. How many times have you ever heard that the Bible, when people say, oh, that's not true about the Bible, that's not true, you know, the walls of Jericho, that's not true, and then they find the walls of Jericho. Oh, that's not true, there was no pilot, then they find out, I was in the place where they found the pilot stone, but they said there's no pilot, and they find, how many know archaeology proves the Bible? But how many know most religions, anything they say, archaeology disproves them? I don't think iron just disappears, right? It doesn't just fade away, right? It wasn't magic spears and they just whoop, you know. I mean, you know, but how many know this? Your Bible that you hold in your hand or your tablet that you hold in your hand, it, you know, electronics, it's either, you either believe it's 100% true or you don't. But here's the neat thing. It's not like we're asking you to have a blind faith and say, just believe it just because I said so. We're not like the higher critics. We say, believe it because of the facts. Amen? If it's true, it should be proved by history. It should be proved by the facts. And here's the fact. So here it is. So he tells Alexander that he was prophesied to come. Alexander the Great was so moved by this that he was in the Bible. It'd be pretty cool to be in the Bible, right? He goes, man, he's so moved that he spared the city of Jerusalem, and the secular history even records this event. You can look it up online. So I don't know how the critics, these, quote, higher critics, could claim that Daniel, honestly, was written in AD 50, 350 years after when it says in the Bible it was written, or 650 years after, when Alexander was touched by it in 322 BC. But here it is. Here's one of the most convincing arguments of all is simply, hear this, Jesus himself. Jesus quotes Daniel, the prophet. He quotes him extensively from his book, and this is found, you can check it out if you're a note taker, just write it, you don't have to go there. Matthew 24:15, he talks about Daniel. And then he talks about it in Mark 13:14, and other places, but it's just two. Whether concerning, hear this, so hear this, when Jesus mentions you, how many know it's true? Because as I said, John 14:6, what? I am the way, Jesus said, the truth, the life. If Jesus quotes you, it's because why? You're true. Amen? Do you see that? If you're quoted by Jesus, like Daniel was, then that's the proof that you're true. Whether concerning evolution, prophecy, divine inspiration of Scripture, or any other topic of debate, always we need to always take the argument back to the person of Jesus Christ. When people say they can't really believe in a literal man named Adam and a woman named Eve, how many know, hear this, guys, we say that's just so hard to believe that just God, you know, God just was and God created Adam and Eve and that's just so hard to believe. Think about this if you ever wondered about evolution. How many know it's a lot harder to believe that nothing decided to be something? And then nothing found something to expand into. Amen? So say if you're nothing and you say I want to be something, then you got to have room to expand. And so who created the room, the expanse to expand in? So guess what? You know what I mean? How many know? I love how that you go to a college or high school, it's the creation theory. But how many know it's the evolution theory too, amen? And they try to say it's based on facts. It's not based on facts. I love what Kent Hovind, before he got arrested, but Kent Hovind, Dr. Dino, said this. He said, you know, he was talking about how all the dogs, how Noah's Ark, and how pretty much there was probably one dog, and all the dogs came from that one dog, a mastiff, and all the dogs, even a little poodle, it's amazing, all came from one dog. And they go, how can you believe that all the hundreds of dogs could come from one dog? And he goes, you guys believe that everything came from a rock. And he goes, no, we don't. And he goes, yes, you do. Remember, the earth was kind of just big primordial soup, and it rained for millions of years on the rock, and finally, all of a sudden, what? Boom, a little amoeba popped out. And then everything came from that. Do you understand my point? I'm not trying to say, I'm saying don't believe the lie that they're so scientific and we're just dumb Christians. Because they have a lot of faith too, amen? And their faith doesn't make sense because their faith is just something decided to be something, you know? I love this. If this is, I'm just going to go with this, keep going until I drive this. But to believe in evolution is to believe that I could take a hand grenade and throw it in a junkyard and I'll have a Rolls Royce. Amen? Chaos, throw a grenade in your house. Some of your rooms look like that, the kids, right? But throw it and see if it makes things better. Amen? Things are made better because of a designer. They're not made better by chance. Amen? Okay? There you go. Clap, yeah. You know? So, yeah. Anyway. But when people say they can't believe in a literal Adam or Eve, then don't argue evolution. Bring the argument back to Jesus. And I tell you this, whenever you talk with people, a lot of times, you know, talk to a Jehovah's Witness, they'll say, well, what about blood transfusion? I go, yeah, whatever. Back to Jesus. Bring it back to Jesus. Always bring it back to the person of Jesus Christ. Bring it back to why Jesus has to be God. Bring it back to them. I've shared sermons like that before, so, you know, of how to witness, but why it's important that Jesus is not a God, but God, because how could, right? Jesus said, only God is sinless, so how could a God or a man die for your sins when he's sinful too, if he's just a man, amen? How many know Jesus has to be God, all right? But bring it back to Jesus. The issue is not so much what you and I think about evolution. The issue is that Jesus spoke about Adam and Eve. And he spoke about them specifically and centered a whole teaching on marriage on Adam and Eve. And so either Jesus, as I said, is a liar, a lunatic, or he is who he said he is. And that's who what? He's the truth. And when Jesus quotes you, he doesn't quote fictional writers, he doesn't quote fictional people. He quotes true events. Unless it's a parable, an allegory, he is quoting real people, real things that happen. So when Jesus quotes it, hear this, you have to believe it. Amen. Or you don't believe in Jesus. I'll never forget once I was talking to a liberal pastor, I was a missionary at this church, and he goes, I only believe in the red. And I said to him, because I'm just a friendly guy, as you guys know, I said, you don't even believe in that. He goes, why do you say that? And he said, because he told me, he goes, I believe Jesus is a way to the Father. For the Buddhist, it's Buddha. For the Muslim, it's Muhammad. And I said, so you don't even believe in the red, because Jesus said in John 14:6, the red, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. You see how bad it gets when you throw little things out? Because then you start unwinding the whole book. You either believe it all or you believe none of it. I always love when people say, well, homosexuality, that's not in the Bible. I don't think that really means what it means. Well, then I always like to say to these people, well, then how do you know that whoever calls upon the name of the Lord, how do you know that's true? Yeah. Everyone believes that scripture, don't you? Yeah. Right? No one wants to believe that's not true, right? Whoever calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. But we need to believe it all. Amen? You believe it all. And so he specifically mentions, so either Jesus, as I said, is a liar or he's the truth. And some of you might be saying, well, Pastor Craig, I believe that, you know, come on, you don't believe in, like, I heard this same pastor say, you know, if you can believe this fish story, you can believe anything, talking about Jonah and the whale. How many know that Jonah and the whale, that has been proven to be true? That can happen, right? I was just watching, I went and saw the movie, Moby Dick, what was it, Heart of the Sea, and they show this kid going in the blowhole of a whale. I mean, they say that's like being in hell. I mean, I can imagine it, you know. But, you know, they really did that stuff. And I mean, so that can really happen. I mean, that, well, it did happen, but it could still happen today. But some people will say, well, that's just a tall tale. They'll mock it. But yet Jesus, who is always truthful, Jesus used Jonah. His story is the three-day stay. He said that, just like the story of Jonah, he said that he used it as the belly of the whale as a picture of his own death, burial, and resurrection. So how many know if Jesus used that story, how many know that wasn't a folk tale, that wasn't a lie, that wasn't made up, that was a real story? Amen? And I heard someone say this too. They go, well, Craig, God will not violate natural laws. How about walking on water? How about ascending up into heaven? Isn't that violating a natural law called gravity? I mean, come on. God doesn't break his laws, but when he created, how many know he can break the law of gravity? That's not, the Bible doesn't say, thou shalt not break gravity. And how many know the Bible say, thou shalt not walk on water? Right? God can't lie. God can't cheat. God can't steal, because those are laws in his word. But how many know God can do pretty much everything else? You know what I mean? If he wants to fly around, he flies. If he wants to walk through your wall, he can walk through your wall. But Lord, the atoms, you got to be, you know, no. When God says all things are possible, he means all things are possible. Amen? So, Jesus, hear this, used some of the most controversial accounts. So don't think your pastor's the only controversial one. He used the most controversial accounts in the Old Testament, Adam and Eve, Jonah and the whale, Daniel, as the bedrock or foundation of his teachings. So guess what? And you remember this too? Do you remember this? What he said? Jesus said, unless you eat my body and drink my blood, you have no part with me. Do you realize to a Jew? I don't know how. I wish I was good at parables. But do you know how offensive that was to a Jew? That'd be like in saying, unless you, I don't know what. I don't even want to be careful. You know what I mean? But it's saying something extreme because you didn't drink blood as a Jew. Right. And you definitely knew not to be a cannibal as a Jew. Okay? Because you weren't supposed to eat unkosher meat. And I'm pretty sure human meat would be unkosher. Right? So you just knew this. But guess what? Jesus said that, and it says many left that day. Do you ever wonder, Jesus being so smart, perfect, why he used that? And the only thing I can say is, what did Jesus say? Thank you, Lord, that you've hid these things from wise and learned men and revealed it unto babes. It's almost like Jesus kind of made a little bit of a stumbling block so that you would have to be really sincere and filled with the Spirit so that the Spirit could sort of explain, he really doesn't mean you're going to eat Jesus. He really doesn't mean you're going to drink his blood. It's a metaphor, a picture, and the Holy Spirit's praying. But guess what? If you're an intellectual coming to God in your own strength and terms, hello, I'm a higher critic from the U of A, you're going to miss it and you go, what ain't wrong? But if you're a babe, if you have a sincere heart saying, I just want you, God, then God will go make it click to where you go, oh. So, and guess what? You think I'm joking about it? The Romans would say that the Christians were cannibals and that they were vampires. They drank blood. So realize that's how the world takes it, that extreme. But Jesus used these accounts. And because his resurrection, the resurrection of Jesus, verifies that everything he said is true. How many know, if you're a fake, how many know it's hard to raise yourself from the dead? It really is. You know what I mean? You know, nowadays with all the comedians, or not comedians, those, what's that guy who raises himself up? The guy from Vegas, you know, the weird dude. How many know that's a lot of trick photography? You know? I mean, that's a lot of, you know, yeah, it's notice you don't see it. I mean, they say it in front of people, but I don't know. Maybe those people have been drinking a lot. I don't know. But, you know, give me a break. I mean, let's see him. Let me shoot you and see you rise from the dead. Bet she's not going to be a taker on that. What do you bet? Right? You know, and so there it is. That resurrection of Christ verifies that all of his references are equally true. Amen? Whenever you're involved in debate or controversies, again, always steer the discussion back to Jesus. And you'll find that all the answers and all the illustrations are found in him. Amen? They're all found in Jesus Christ. The book of Daniel confounds the critics, but it comforts the Christian. Amen? It comforts it because his book confirms our faith. When people ask how we know that the prophecy in the Bible will come to pass, we can turn them to the book of Daniel and say, Daniel made many predictions about the Babylonians, about the Medo-Persians, the Greeks, and the Roman empires centuries before it ever happened. Amen. And those events all came to pass. Right. Amen? Amen? Therefore, we know that what he speaks of that is yet to come, we can be confident that it will come to pass. Amen? It's going to come to pass. When he talks about the abomination of desolation, when he talks about the Antichrist entering the remade, rebuilt temple, how many know we can have confidence there's going to be a new temple? And how many know I've been to the Temple Institute in Jerusalem, and I've seen they have all the, that was like 7-8 years ago, but they had almost all the temple instruments done. It was so wild to see the altar of incense that will be in the temple. Has anyone else seen that? Did you ever see it? But it's the altar of incense that will be in the temple, the new temple. And it's gold leaf. The whole thing's gold. I mean, it's just like that is the altar of incense, like in the Old Testament. That's the one that's going to be in the new temple. Are you serious? Yes, I am serious. That is amazing. It is amazing. And to know that it's going to, because a part of our brain goes, how can that happen? Do you know what's on the Temple Mount? But you remember, I don't know how many of you have been here long enough. You know, some of you kind of come and go, but hear this. Do you remember the neat thing it says in Isaiah, I believe it's Isaiah, that says, mark off the courts of the Gentiles. Is that Isaiah? Yeah. Mark off the courts of the Gentiles. And I showed you that if you look at the Temple Mount, I forget it's how many acres it is. It's really big. But you look where the Dome of the Rock is, that's really the court of the Gentiles. So what they're believing, theologians smarter than me. I'm just saying what they said. They believe that what will happen is the Antichrist will come on the scene. This is some theory. This is a theory. I'm not saying thus saith the Lord. This is a theory. Interesting. But they'll draw a line, and what the Antichrist will do is let's have the Dome of the Rock here and then put the temple on, if you're looking from the Mount of Olives, it would be on the right side. Because remember me showing you a little picture of colonnade of the tablets, or it's called the altar of, or the I forget it, it's called the altar of spirits or the spirit. And what they believe is this little, you'll see this little colonnade, this little like arch thing. And that's where they believe the Holy of Holies was. That's where the Ark of the Covenant was. And you can see that's way far away from where the Dome of the Rock is. So do you see how that could possibly be? It could possibly, because I asked the Jewish guy who's the head of the Sanhedrin, and I said to him, I go, what are you going to do with that little gold thing up there? Because you could see the Dome of the Rock. And he says, here's what he says to me, he looks at me. It must be removed. That wouldn't cause it. Would anyone notice that, you think? Yeah. And so, I mean, wow. You know, I was like, and they said they've had people up there ready to blow it up, but they've stopped. The Israelis have stopped it because they don't want, you know, that would definitely start a war. But anyways, interesting stuff to know that's going to happen. To know not maybe there's going to be a temple. There's going to be a temple. And that the Antichrist is going to be largely a part of why there's a temple. And then the Jews are going to think, he's the hero. And then guess what? He's going to then halfway through 3.5 years, he's going to say, guess what? Who's your daddy? I am not Jesus. I am me. I am Satan. And he'll set up an image to be worshipped. And the Jews will go, and then they'll run to Petra. And that's where it says in Matthew 24, you know, don't be pregnant. Don't be talking about the Jews. Anyway, enough of that. That was all free. So, but hear this. Some people think that we're, as Calvaryites, we're so obsessed with prophecy. Some people say I don't talk about prophecy enough, but I think I do. But we're obsessed with prophecy. But the reason we talk about prophecy so much as Calvaryites, as basically Bible teachers, is because 1/4 of the Bible is prophetic. Do you hear that? 1/4. No other book is like that. I mean, even the Quran. Remember the Quran? Remember how Muhammad was, he believes in one God, and somehow Satan tricked him and he had the wrong letter. What was that? You know what I'm talking about? I feel like Steve Martin here. Remember when the aliens took all the smart people and left the never mind. You know, I'm not kidding. It's called the Satanic Letter. Or you remember that? The guy wrote it and he had to run for his life. What was it called? The Satanic Verses. But basically, if you know the Quran, they believe in one God, right? But what happened was he said Lucifer tricked him, and so he wrote about many gods. And yet, it's called the Satanic Letter or whatever. But anyways, how many know that's not good when your book has a little bit of error like that? But how many know you don't have that in the Bible? The only errors you have, we believe in the perfection of the Word of God that is inerrant, infallible, without flaw. The only flaws there are today is flaws of the writers, the translators. And guess what? Hear this, guys, so you can be encouraged. The Dead Sea Scrolls, the Isaiah you have and the Isaiah that they have in the Dead Sea Scrolls only has, I believe, up to 7 or 8 discrepancies. And out of that, that's what, 58 chapters, I think? It only has, or maybe more, 60, 50, but it has only 7 discrepancies, and it's not enough to change the context. How many of that's pretty amazing? Just play telephone. Just try to say one little phrase in this little group and see how it'll be, you know, I could say the Lord is good, and then it'll be like, you know, JCPenney has a sale. You know what I mean? It's like, you know, I mean, give me a break. That is amazing, right? But hear this too. Prophecy also, believing why it's so important to teach prophecy is because prophecy has a tremendous purifying effect. The prophecies of Jesus returning has a tremendous effect on our faith and walk with Jesus. After speaking about the coming of Jesus, John, the Apostle John, said this in John, 1 John 3:3. He said, whoever has this hope purifies himself. And what's that hope? The hope is of the return of Jesus. How many know Jesus is coming back soon? He said, just the way he left, he's coming back. Mount of Olives, boom, split it. It's kind of neat. That's another thing I can tell you about, but it'd take too long. But just so many neat things. Because, well, I'll just tell you this. I got to say this. The Muslims have said they know he's going to come back in the Mount of Olives. They know he's going to come through the Golden Gate. So what have they done? They know, oh, Jesus is a priest. He's like a priest. He's a holy man. So they'll put graves all in front of the door where he's going to come in and enter in the temple. We're going to stop the Messiah. No. Jesus is like, dun-dun-dun. Jesus comes back in the Mount of Olives. Boom. Splits it open. Plows it up. All those graves. Right in, baby. And no walking over any graves, because a holy man cannot walk over a grave. So that's why they mark them all white. Amen. How many like that stuff? That is so cool to me. You know, you see all these graves, you go, they're not going to be there very long, you know, very soon, you know, someday. But anyways, but those who have this hope will purify themselves. What? Truly believing the prophecy that Jesus is coming back, that he could come back right now. How many know? Hear this, guys. There's not one thing that needs to happen for Jesus to come back. Not one thing. We don't have to wait for Ted Cruz to be president for Jesus to come back. We don't. No, he can come back at any time. Right now, a blink of an eye. Boom, just a millisecond. Boop. Now, how many know? A lot of us really don't believe that. And you go, what do you mean? Yes, I do. No, you don't. And you go, how do you know? Hear it. He who has this hope purifies himself. Because if you believe that Jesus could come back any second, you don't want to get caught. Hear this, forgive my crassness, but you don't want to get caught with your pants down. You don't want to get caught doing things you shouldn't do. Amen? You don't want to get caught being ungodly. You want to live ready. Because Jesus could come back right this second. I could be pricked. You ever seen that video where the people, the pastor's preaching, I was like, boom, and it's gone. There's like 2 people left in the congregation. They're like, what happened? If you believe that, and I truly believe that, it will change the way we live. And what does it say in the last days? People become scoffers. Oh, God, the church has been talking about the Lord coming back for years. What did he say? He's going to come like a thief. Have you ever had a thief say to you, how's Tuesday work? I'm going to come about 3:30. I'm going to ravage your house. You know, I might even shoot you. But does that work for you? I mean, you know, if we would be like, are you here, kitty, kitty? Right? I mean, we'd be ready. But a thief comes when you least expect it. And Jesus said that. Not that he's a thief, but he says, I'm going to come when you think I'm not coming. Because if you knew the thief was coming, you'd be ready. Right? And so we need to remember that, hear that verse, maybe write that down, maybe put on your mirror, maybe put on your car, but hang it, because it should change the way we live. We talk about, you know, another reason that we talk about prophecy is found in Daniel 12:4. And I'm just going ahead, kind of giving an overview. But it says, you, Daniel, shut up the words, talking about this book, the book of Daniel, and seal the book until the time of the end, which is now. Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall increase. Now hear this. According to that prophecy, in the end times, which is, do we all believe we're in the end times? I mean, my goodness. Look at all that's happening. Russia, China, everyone's coming to the party. Oh my goodness. Putin is now more popular than our president. Who would ever think a communist would be better than our, who's like, I will save the day. How many know we're living in some fun days? But how many know, without Jesus, you want to, but with Jesus, you go, it's not all going according to his will, but it's going according to his plan. Nothing is shocking Jesus. Do you know that? That's why it's important to know prophecy. It's important to know, as I preached a couple weeks ago, that Jesus holds all things together. That means he's holding this world together. That means that, yes, he nothing is blindsided. He didn't go, Putin's going to, what's Putin doing? He didn't do that. He didn't go, Obama, I didn't expect him to be the president for 8 years. What's going on? He knew exactly what is going on, and he's still working together for good to what? Those of you who love him and are called according or given to his purposes. That's why I always press you guys. I don't preach a nice little sermon of kumbaya, my Lord, kumbaya. Because guess what, church? We're not pulling the truck up the hill. If we were living such great lives, why isn't Jesus moving so much in America? See, this is what I don't like, Pastor Craig. Right here, I'm feeling good until now. But I say this to you because I want you to be ready. I want you to be an influence to your children, to your spouse that's unsaved, to your friends and family members, to your coworkers. I want you to be a witness. I don't want you to be part of this world anymore. We're to be in this world, but not of it. And let's say, to be honest, church, I'll just say it to me. This world has a lot more hold on me and affecting me a lot of times more than Christ in me is affecting this world. I'd like to see that change, wouldn't you? Yes. Two of you want to change. That's nice. How come in a football game? Woo! But here. But according to this prophecy, the end times, there will be an explosion of knowledge. You notice that? Think about what you have on your phone, your smartphone. You can look up everything. I have people like, Pastor Craig, excuse me, it says right here, you're wrong. Sorry. Because the internet's always right. But we have at the fingertips, right? Everything, boom, 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 instant. But how many know, with all this knowledge, we're still not that smart? Isn't it amazing? That's amazing to me. We have all this knowledge and we still, child abuse going through the roof. Divorce going through the roof. It's like knowledge isn't making us better people. Amen? But it makes us know what we're doing wrong, but how many knowledge is not what changes you? God is what changes you. Right? Aren't all of you this year like me? I was dieting, right? I was losing weight. Guess what? I've been naughty. And I tell you, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? January? I'm going to lose weight. I'm keeping it off this time. This is it. Till I see a chocolate eclair. Ooh. I think that's the Lord's will for me right there. But how many know you got to finally, it's God plus a desire to say enough. Amen? I said enough because I looked at pictures of me. I'm sitting there, I'm with Ted Cruz. I'm taking a picture with Ted Cruz. And I'm sitting there and I have my suit on and I'm like this. And I look like Boss Hog. Remember the Dukes? I look with the white, I just needed a white suit. I had a black suit, but I was like, how you doing? I was like, oh, Lord, please. That's got to stop, I remember the skinny you. I remember the skinny me. I don't see the real me that you see. You got to go, there was a skinny you? Really? Really, really? I got to show you a skinny me picture. You won't believe. I was like, I could have been one of the, you paint me black, I could have been a poster for World Vision. I promise. Tell me, isn't it true? It's true, isn't it? You look at me and go, what? My wife goes, what happened? Haagen-Dazs, baby, Haagen-Dazs. Okay, all right. I go. Let's get some Haagen-Dazs. My wife's so frugal, such a good buyer. She buys the case of Haagen-Dazs from Costco, and I feel the need to get rid of it. Anyways, I gotta get moving here. But he says the end times, there will be an explosion of knowledge, not only intellectually, but also concerning end times understanding or end times prophecies. But he said to them, when he wrote the book of Daniel, God said to Daniel, seal the book right now because people of your age are not going to understand this. This is for the future. That's why the critics say, oh, this couldn't have been written when it was, because it's so detailed about the future and it's been so accurate, and it had to have been written in AD 50. The Lord says that most people are not going to understand it, but we, you and I, it'll make sense to us, those who are living in the last days. There's a great amount of teaching on prophecy today because we are living in the last days. And suddenly so much of the prophetic mysteries are starting to really make sense to us. Not only is the book of Daniel important in the light of prophecy, but hear this, what a blessing it is to study the life of Daniel, a man of a great integrity. Even in his own day, Daniel was a legend. How many like to be a legend for godliness? I like to be a patriarch. I like my kids to go, oh, Grandpa Roters, he was chubby, but boy, he loved the Lord. I mean, wouldn't you love that? Wouldn't you love that? That somebody talks, your kids, your grandkids talk well about you, they'll go, oh, yeah, Grandpa, I've talked about the Lord, but I didn't live it. I don't want that. And I know you don't want that if you're sincere. You want your kids to say, oh, my goodness, my grandpa. We talk about Teresa's grandpa all the time. Brings tears to my eyes. Just the way he lived was so not. You know how there's someone when they're really godly, you're around them, you just want to be godly. All of a sudden, you kind of, praise the Lord. I mean, you know, you just want to be godly because he is so godly. Not, you know, you're just like, my goodness, I got to get saved because I'm going to be around grandpa. You know what I mean? I want to be like that. I want to, as I said, I don't want to be a thermostat that just kind of registers wherever I'm around. Thermometer. I want to be a thermostat where I change the climate around me. Amen? I don't want this world to squeeze me into its mold. I want Christ in me to affect those around me for good. Amen? He was a legend. One of his contemporaries, Ezekiel, even puts him in the same category as Job and Noah. How many know that's pretty awesome? Job and Noah, right? And that's found in Ezekiel 14:14. In fact, hear this, you'll love this. He's one of the only people in the Old Testament characters of whom no sin is mentioned. Isn't that amazing? How many people in the Bible have no? Now, David was a man after God's own heart, but we know some sin. But no sin is mentioned about Daniel. Now, this doesn't mean that Daniel was sinless. Don't get that. But it means, hear this. It means his life was not given to sin. How many know we need young men and women like that today and old men that are not given to sin? Doesn't mean you're gonna fail, right? Remember? I love what one person, a coach, said this, that grace is like when I say, Morgan, go out for a pass. Are you going to catch that pass? And Morgan goes, oh, yeah, Dad, I want to catch that pass. I'm like, okay, it's really important. And I throw the ball at him. He goes, bloo, bloo, and he does, and he misses it. That's when grace comes in, amen? But if I say, son, are you going to catch the ball? No, probably not. How many know that's not what grace was meant for? It was never meant for willful sin. It was never meant for, oh, whatever, dude. And that's the way we've used grace today. But grace is meant for when you sincerely, like Daniel, are living for God, and yet that guy cuts you off, and all of a sudden, that's when there's grace. Yeah. Amen? When things come in your mouth. Where did that come from? It was deep in there somewhere, wasn't it? I never forget. So cute. We had the alarm, and this is our old place, and someone couldn't work the alarm, and they're like, oh, and I was like, whoa, praise the Lord. And they're like, the red face, red, you know. They go, I can't believe I said that. I go, well, I believe you did. I think there's three words that characterize the life of Daniel. The first is this, for those who are note takers, is purpose. He was a man who purposed in his heart that he would walk with God, that he would live for God, that he would not compromise against his God. And the proof of that is Daniel 6:10. Remember that? Remember when he was the best administrator and all the guys got jealous of him? And they said, we got to find a way. They tried to find if there's anything against him. They couldn't. He just was so integrous, had so much integrity. So they said, here's what we're going to do. He prays three times a day. We're going to make a mandate that he can't pray to his God, that he can only pray to the king. And if he prays to his God, then he'll be arrested and thrown in the lion's den. How many know people are going to try to do that in America, stuff like that? You can't pray. You can't do this. You can't talk about homosexuality. You can't say it's sin, or you're going to go to jail. But what did Daniel do? Read, not now, but Daniel 6:10. It says he went what? He says as soon as he heard it, he didn't go, oh God, what do I? He went and prayed as was his custom. Amen. And you know the story. What happened? He went and prayed. They said, king, yeah, he's breaking the law. He's praying to his God, not you. And what happens? Threw him in the lion's den. The king couldn't sleep. He's all bummed. I love Daniel. Oh, this is wrong. But when you made a law back then, you couldn't reverse it. That's how, isn't that amazing? So they made this law. Oh, so he says he woke up early in the morning, ran to the lion's den, says, Daniel, you're all right? He goes, I'm all right, king. And the king goes, oh, who are those guys that told on Daniel? And says they were thrown in the lion's den, and their whole family, their children, everyone. And it says their bodies were torn to pieces before they hit the ground. Daniel didn't have one scratch on him. How many know you live for God, you're a man or woman of integrity, God will protect you a lot of times miraculously. But you kind of compromise, you kind of do the world's way, guess what? You know, God isn't great on a curve of sin, right? You ever have a problem where you have a problem with somebody and you go, and you're kind of a little mean to them, but they're not as mean, you're not as mean to them as they were to you? God doesn't go, well, you were less mean, so I guess I'll defend you. No mean. Bless your enemies. Pray for them. You know what I mean? I've realized that when people hurt me, I went, I can't. God's even rebuking me a lot of times for saying the truth about someone. He's saying, but are you slandering them? And I go, slander is, because don't you think a slander is lying? Don't you? But you know the definition in the early Webster's Christian Dictionary, the 1828, whatever? He says slander is doing anything to hurt someone's reputation. Sometimes I tell the truth about people to sort of make them look not so good. And I need to be careful with that. Some of you just need to work on slander. But how many know, just saying lies about people. But how many know, even saying something to try to hurt someone. Now sometimes we have to tell the truth about someone. But sometimes we, you know how you'd be led by the Spirit? Is this malicious? Is this kind of like, And God has had to say, Craig, zip it. Because I don't defend a little bit of sin. You know, I don't say, well, you sinned less than that. You know what I mean? We need to be men. Do you remember what Jesus said? The only place where he says, be perfect is your Heavenly Father is perfect. Remember what that was in? Forgiveness. Said, even sinners love sinners. But I ask you to love your enemy. Pray for those who despitefully use you. And be perfect as your Heavenly. That's how we show God we are really wanting to be like him. That's free too. Second, he was a man of prayer. I'll tell you this, I am so convinced, prayer. My wife was reading Father Nash. He was the one who prayed for Finney, who had the second great awakening in America. He prayed, he'd pray like 12 hours a day. We have a hard time praying 12 minutes. He prayed 12 hours. When he died, Finney's ministry, what, quit in like months? Was it months, Teresa? I think he quit months later. That's how much he depended on Father Nash's prayer. Father Nash would go into a city, if Finney was going, he'd go there a week or two before and start praying and crying out. I want to tell you this, guys, hear this. If you can, and you don't like the way I preach, but you kind of want to be here. Some people say, I like the church, I just don't like pastor. Then pray for me. Pray. Pray, God, help him. Please help him. You know, pray for me. Because that's what all these great men said. What made them great was not them, was God in them, was because people were the people of God were praying for them. Spurgeon said, either he's a liar or he's telling the truth. And he said, it's because of 200 people that pray, that there's always 200 people praying for me every day in my basement of the church. We need prayer. Amen? Because, like I said, knowledge is not the answer. We need a move of God. We need people's hearts to say, you know what, I'm tired of sin. I'm tired of this, right? Who can make that except God? Who can make someone say, enough is enough? I don't know. I can't. It's not my preaching. I can't make you guys. A lot of you guys go, amen, amen. But I'm not doing it. But only God can make you go, amen, And yes, God, help me to do this. I'm tired of this. I don't want to live like this anymore. The third and last point is he was a man of prophecy. He was interested in prophecy. He waited on the Lord, as the Bible says in Psalms 46:10, be still and know that I'm God. He waited on God, and so he was God's mouthpiece. How many know we need to have prophetic voice today? We need to not maybe prophetic like Daniel in the sense of preaching end times, but we need to be able to speak prophetically. How many know we need to know how our kids are doing sometimes? I'll never forget, God bless my little girl, I love her. I always pick on Mariah. But I'll never forget, I was asking Mariah, Mariah, you listen to some bad music? This is a couple years ago. This is like, what, a month ago? No, okay. Years ago. And I said, Mariah, you listen to bad music? She goes, no, not at all, Daddy. I said, man, I kind of feel like you are. I don't know why, I just felt that. So then all of a sudden, I'm in Wednesday night service, and I'm praying, and I'm worshiping, and all of a sudden, the Lord says, you need to talk to your daughter. She's listening to bad music. Friends are influencing her. And tell her, this is from me. Stop. I went and said that to her. She goes, okay, Daddy. Okay, right. Yeah. Love you, baby. And now she's a perfect girl. Look at her. Right? But do you know my point? We need to be able to hear from God. We need to be able to discern things. We need to know. You know what I mean? Wouldn't you like to have discernment where if some Al-Qaeda guy walks in your restaurant, you could kind of go, stranger, danger, right? And not go, hey, oh my goodness. Amen. I got you scared there, didn't I? I don't want to think about that. These three points should cause us to say, Lord, make us men like Daniel and women like Daniel, who have purpose in our hearts to serve you. Make us people of prayer. And make us people who study your word so that we might know what the Bible says about the last days. That we might remember that you're in control, even though this world seems like it's spinning out of control. Amen? Because we're living in the last days. And the last days, the Bible says, are going to get crazier. Amen? It's like that old song, you ain't seen nothing yet. Bow, 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 baby. You know, it's getting crazy. Have you noticed? We can't call wrong, wrong. We can't call right, right. You know, can I just say this to you just to show you how crazy? And I don't know, maybe I'm just concerned about things, but I love when I heard this Israeli Defense Force, the IDF. He said, we could stop the Islamic terrorist stuff real quick in America. How many like to see it stop? He says, one, we have to call it what it is. It's Islamic extremism. It's jihad. It's a radical religion. And we need to say that. And we need to say, I'm sorry, but if that offends you, I'm sorry. Don't they do that with Christians? One Christian blows up an abortion clinic, then all Christians are bad, aren't we? Didn't Rosie O'Donnell say that we're equal to ISIS people? She did. So we need to name it what it is. And that, see, we can't, though. And I like, why do you think Donald Trump, you know, his ratings went up for saying that? Because people are getting tired of being politically correct. And I love, I don't know who it was that said, our politically correctness is going to kill us. So we need to say, speak, we need to learn to speak black is black, white is white, truth is truth. Not sort of kind, I don't know. He said we need to do that. And then he says, one, we need to stop. He says we have 100 mosques. And out of those 100 mosques that he went around randomly and got people to go in, kind of spy that were Arabs, but are, you know, that I guess they're sane Arabs. They said that out of the 100 mosques in America, 80% of them are preaching jihad or have literature on jihad. And Amnon said, here's the same thing. Now here, again, politically correct. We have freedom of religion, amen, yes. Unless your religion preaches killing people. Right. Then we say, you don't have the freedom to preach that religion. And I can't remember now the third thing. But do you hear what it's just saying? It's saying common sense. And then we need to really said vet people properly. But you know, do you see why I preach this to you? And I look at some of you going, why do you say this in the church? Because if it doesn't start here, where is it going to start? Amen. We're supposed to be the people of truth. And I'm not preaching hate. Did I say hate a Muslim? Did I say that? I'm just saying, let's be clear in what, let's call, as the Bible says in the last days, men will call good, evil, good, and good, evil. Let's call evil, evil, and good, good. Amen. Let's just be clear. And Daniel was that. And prophecy shows you that, because prophecy says that things like this are going to happen. Do you realize this? Hear this. I was listening to O'Reilly say, I don't know what it is with our president. Is he trying to destroy our country, or is he just incompetent? That's like asking chicken or the egg. Who cares? But hear this. When you understand prophecy, why is this happening? Because we've got to have chaos in the world for the Antichrist to come on the scene. Amen? Do you think how broken America has to be to where we will let some European leader say, here I come to save the day? But when you understand prophecy, you go, oh, I don't like it, but I get it. And that's why, hear me, some of you go, but I don't want to be here much longer. Well, if we're going to be here, let's do our best to restrain evil. Amen? Amen. Let's do our best to be effective for good and not just sit back in our houses and let evil triumph. Because to me, that's the wicked, lazy servant. We need to speak the truth. We need to pray, and we need to be like Daniel and know what's happening. Be able to read the signs. Remember, Jesus expected them. You can't read the signs. You can tell the weather. How many know us? We all look at our smartphone. Oh, it's going to freeze tonight. But he says, you don't know the signs of the times in the last days. We need to study our Bible, and that's what we're going to do with the book of Daniel. Amen? So you can know, so we can be truthful, so we can speak, and so we can have effect. Because I tell you, I've said to the Lord right here the other night in tears, either move again, Lord, or please take us home. Anyone agree with that? Amen. Take us home or move, because I don't like the way it is right now. You know? So, there I go. I went long again. I'm not supposed to say that. So I didn't go long. I went really good. No. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for your love, and I thank you for everyone here. Lord, I pray that, I just want to say, first of all, to you guys, you can look up for a second. I just want to thank you guys for enduring sound doctrine. You know, the Bible says in the last days, men will not endure sound doctrine. It's not that they won't want teaching, they just won't want sound teaching. But it says they'll get teachers around them that tickle their ears and tell them what their itching ears want to hear, kind of the kumbaya. I want to say thank you to everyone here that you endure sound doctrine. You endure the hard things of the word. Amen? So pat yourself on the back there, right? Okay. But Father, thank you so much for these people. Thank you for their hearts, and may this group grow. May it grow where people are sick and tired of being sick and tired. Where people are saying, you know what, I don't want the world according to the world. I want the world according to what your word says. Amen? I want the truth. I want to know your truth, because you said it's your truth that will set us free. Not a mixture of truth from your Bible and the world, but it's just you, Lord. And so, Father, I pray that as we study the book of Daniel, it will have its perfect work in us. That we will become men who are purpose in our heart to be sold out for you, and women. And that we will become men and women of prayer. That we will cry out and pray for a move of God in this land once more. And that, Father, we will be people who will be like Daniel, who will know prophecy. That we will wait on you, we'll study your word, we'll pray, and we'll hear what your spirit is saying to us. We might not be like Daniel in the sense we'll know when the date is or anything, because your word says not, but we will know the signs of the times. We'll be aware of what's going on. We won't be caught off guard, but we'll be aware, and we'll be able to pray, and we will not be shocked, and we won't go, where is God? We'll know that you're working. We'll believe and really live Romans 8:28, that you're working all things, even the bad things. You're working for good to those who love you and are called, or what it really means, given to you, Lord. Let us be given to you. I was going to read this, but since I went late, about the 10 virgins, the bridesmaids. And it says that 5 of them were ready. They were filled with the Holy Spirit. That's what the oil means. They were filled with the Holy Spirit. They were ready for the Lord's return. That's what that picture is. But 5 weren't ready. 5 didn't have the oil. They had their lamps, but they didn't have enough oil. And that's talking about those who are kind of religious, those who are playing games. Remember what happens? The bridegroom comes, and the 5 virgins who are ready, they go with him. But then the 5 that had to go get oil because they weren't prepared, they weren't ready, they weren't filled with your spirit, weren't walking with you, then it says they knocked on the door and said, let us in. And he said, no, depart from me, I never knew you. Lord, my heart is that everyone in this room would know you. That everyone in this room would be filled with your Spirit and be walking by your Spirit. So that when you come in the twinkling of an eye, that they are ready. They're not having to rush out and get right with you or get filled with the Spirit. They have been living, waiting in expectancy for you. And they're excited about your return. Amen? And so, Lord, let that belief of 1 John 3:3, that you, the hope, that hope purifies, that you could come at any second. It's going to purify us because we know if we really believe that, we're not going to do the things our flesh might tempt us to do. Because we know Jesus could be coming at any second, and he's going to come any second. So, Lord, purify this church and others like it. Purify that with that hope that this is truly the last days. And let it sanctify us. Let it give us an urgency to proclaim and share the good news with our unsaved friends and family, with our coworkers. Let us realize that even though this world is crazy, we have to be able to slow down and realize it's not about the biggest car or the nicest house. It's about we're here to be fishers of men. Amen. We're here to save people. We're here to share the gospel and share the good news of Jesus. That's why we're here. So, Lord, let your church have its priorities right. Let us be about your business. Let us have our lamps full of your Spirit. Let us be waiting with great expectancy for your return. We thank you, Lord, and thank you for this book of Daniel. I pray that you'll speak to us. I pray that it'll change the way we live. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.